Hi, let's talk about the osteology of the orbit. The orbit is the region of the cranium where the eye and supporting structures and neurovasculature of the eye live. Colloquially, we would refer to this as the eye socket. And it is comprised of several different bones. I'd like to start here with this color-coded skull so that we can best visualize how these bones relate to one another. So the first bone that I'd like to draw your attention to forms the front of the cranium, ergo the frontal bone, and it is going to be largely the roof of the orbit. So I'll just outline the portion of the frontal here that's contributing to the orbit, and you can see that the overabundance of the roof of the orbit is formed by this bone. We also, if we move inferior from the bone, right here, have the lacrimal bone. The lacrimal bone gets its name not from the lacrimal gland, because the lacrimal gland is found up in the lacrimal fossa of the frontal bone, but because this is the osseous feature through which tears, or the secretions of the lacrimal gland, are drained through the nasolacrimal duct. And so looking at this bone posteriorly here, and I'll thicken this, this would be the lacrimal crest, or the posterior lacrimal crest, and there's also a slight groove there called the lacrimal groove. Now you may notice that on the next bone that we'll discuss, there is also a lacrimal groove. So there is a lacrimal groove of the lacrimal bone, and there is a lacrimal bone of the maxilla. But let's talk a little bit about the maxilla before we go into any particular details. So the maxilla is famous for being the superior of the two teeth-bearing bones of the skull. And in terms of its role in the orbit, it's largely the floor of the orbit. So here we can see the maxilla in its role of floor for the orbit. We can also see that there is a nice extension of the maxilla here. This is the frontal process of the maxilla that's separating the lacrimal bone from the nasal bone. A lot of osteology is named fairly well. So in this case, this frontal process of the maxilla is named because it's reaching out and coming into contact with the frontal bone. You should think about process names because they might describe either the shape of the feature, the relationship of that feature to some other feature, or they might be even in direct contact with the feature for which they're named. Regardless, if you look just adjacent to the lacrimal groove of the lacrimal bone, there's going to be another groove, and it's hard to tell this because that frontal process is in the way, but there's another groove on the maxilla, also called the lacrimal groove, and the two lacrimal grooves are adjacent to one another. Moving right along, or I should say, let's move clockwise. We have the zygomatic bone. So the zygomatic bone here is the cheekbone, sometimes just called the zygoma. And in terms of the orbit, it is largely going to be the lateral wall of the orbit. Now the feature or the surface of the zygomatic bone that comes into play for the orbit is known as the orbital surface. So that is well named, I suppose. And if we look at the very back of the orbit, we see that that posterior wall, everything that is here in yellow, is the sphenoid bone. The sphenoid bone is a remarkably complex and beautiful bone that you can see There are many different views of the skull. Much of it is going to be obscured by other elements of anatomy, but it's a very important central bone that's really tying together a lot of osseous, muscular, and neurovascular features. We'll go into greater detail regarding the sphenoid bone. But if we continue our tour, you might notice, and let me erase this here so that we can better see, you might notice that just between the sphenoid and the lacrimal bone, there is another bone to be seen. And this is the ethmoid. The ethmoid forms the medial wall of the orbit. Now, all of these are just very rough description. So medial wall of the orbit, lateral wall of the orbit, floor, roof, you know, we can see how some of these other bones are also going to contribute to these structures. It's also important to note that the orbit isn't a cube, it's not a box, it's not a perfect geometrical shape by any stretch of the imagination. We conceptualize the orbit as sort of a medially facing cone. And so the apex of that cone is there. And this is an important lesson to learn with respect to the extraocular muscles. In particular, the rectus muscles, superior and inferior, because this arrangement of where these muscles are attached to relative to the eye is going to have a profound effect on the actions of these muscles that go beyond the basic insertion points on the sclera of the eye. So think about this relationship, this structure of the orbit, as you consider the actions of the extraocular muscles. That will be exceedingly important. Also important to note is that the paranasal sinuses are going to be in close communication with the orbit in various ways, but just, you know, geographically, the frontal sinus within the frontal bone is going to be abutting the orbit. The ethmoidal sinus, which would be very deep here, is going to be abutting both orbits. The sphenoidal sinus, which is even further back posteriorly, will be abutting the orbits. And then the maxillary sinus is going to be abutting the orbits. So all of those paranasal sinuses, whereas they communicate with the nasal cavity, are also going to be very close to the orbit. Now let's look at the frontal bone here. Recall, you know, it is the front of the neurocranium. And there are two features that that we'd really like you to understand here with the frontal bone. The first is the lacrimal fossa. The lacrimal fossa is the osseous feature that denotes where the lacrimal gland lives. And the lacrimal gland is a lateral feature in the superior orbit. So this indentation here on the frontal bone is the lacrimal fossa. We also have a trochlear fovea. Trochlear fovea. Recall that the trochlear nerve, cranial nerve 4, serves the superior oblique muscle. Superior oblique muscle is running from the apex of the orbit, from the apex of the orbit along the medial wall, and its tendon runs through the trochlea, which attaches there to this trochlear fovea, and it runs over to the sclera on the superior surface of the eye. And so that trochlear fovea is associated with the trochlea there. And sometimes we could even see a tiny little spine of of bone that's associated with the attachment of the trochlea there. All right, the sphenoid bone. Again, the sphenoid is a fairly secretive bone. We catch glimpses of it. It's most significant in the orbit as the posterior wall of the orbit. And there are a couple of features here that we're going to want to know about. And these are very important features for the conveyance of neurovasculature. So let's start here. That's the optic canal. The optic canal is the osseous canal through which cranial nerve 2, that's the optic nerve, as well as the ophthalmic artery runs. So cranial nerve 2 and the ophthalmic artery run through the optic canal. That leaves us with the orbital fissures. There's a superior orbital fissure and an inferior orbital fissure to denote their relationships to one another. So here is that superior orbital fissure. There is that inferior orbital fissure. The superior orbital fissure is really within the sphenoid bone, whereas the inferior orbital fissure is between the sphenoid bone and the maxilla. Running through that superior orbital fissure are quite a lot of features. So we have both the superior and inferior divisions of cranial nerve 3. That's the oculomotor nerve. We also have cranial nerve 4, the trochlear nerve. We have branches of V1, which is the ophthalmic nerve or the ophthalmic division of the trigeminal nerve. And then we also have the abducens, which is cranial nerve 6. So if you recall, 3, 4, and 6 are all serving those extraocular muscles. In addition, we also have sympathetic fibers that make their way through that superior orbital fissure. And then finally, elements of the ophthalmic veins. And conceptually, there are superior and inferior divisions of the ophthalmic veins, and generally branches of both go through that superior orbital fissure. The inferior orbital fissure has significantly fewer things running through it. So that inferior orbital fissure down here is going to convey zygomatic branches of V2. V2, which is the mandibular nerve, the thrust of it is actually moving inferior to the orbit, just below the floor of the orbit, on the way out to come out the infraorbital foramen as the infraorbital nerve, if you recall that. There's also branches of V2 which are going down to serve the maxillary teeth, etc. So V2 is kind of a mid-face, a deep mid-face nerve for that. And then also, at times, the inferior ophthalmic vein will run through the inferior orbital fissures as well. So that inferior ophthalmic vein is a little promiscuous with respect to its route. It could be the superior orbital fissure, it could be the inferior, it could actually be both if there are two of them. So that is the elements of the sphenoid that participate in the orbit. Let's talk a little bit about the ethmoid. So the ethmoid, like the sphenoid, is a very secretive bone. It's probably an even more secretive bone than the sphenoid. Some of the elements that you're going to want to know about include this perpendicular plate, of the ethmoid, as well as the superior and middle nasal concha. We can't see the superior one. It's going to be higher up there. So those are the elements of the ethmoid that relate here, at least to this particular view. And we'll see how the orbit and the nasal cavity relate to one another in terms of the neurovasculature that that are held in common between these two regions. Also, the orbital plate of the ethmoid, so looking at the orbit from this view, so keeping in mind that the maxilla is the floor, the frontal is the roof, and then here is our ethmoid bone. And the ethmoid separates from the sphenoid about there. Sometimes seeing these sutures are imperfect. And then between the frontal and the ethmoid, it's about there. So the orbital plate is this surface. That'd be the surface of the ethmoid that's forming the medial wall of the orbit. And then we have two foramina. There is a posterior ethmoidal foramen and an anterior ethmoidal foramen. And these are going to be for the conveyance of the ethmoidal neurovasculature. So osteology is usually exquisitely named. So running into that posterior ethmoidal foramen will be things like the posterior ethmoidal artery and nerve and vein. Running into the anterior will be the anterior ethmoidal artery and anterior ethmoidal nerve. These will take different courses as they move through the ethmoidal. And we also have this view of the ethmoid bone. And from this view of the ethmoid bone, we can see, I'll just outline it for you, the cribriform plate. The cribriform plate is very much full of these holes. These are the olfactory foramina, and it's through these holes that the olfactory nerves run. So cranial nerves one. Separating left side from right side there is this crista galli. So crista is a comb, and galli is meaning chicken. So this is the rooster's comb. And this is going to separate the olfactory bulbs on top of the cribriform plate on either sides. So in this video, we discussed the bony orbit. We talked about the bones which comprise the orbit. So the frontal, the lacrimal, the maxilla, the zygomatic, the sphenoid, and the ethmoid, and some of their features. Thank you very much for your time.